So I'm Angela Vang, and you guys know a little bit about me, but before we actually get started, I want to introduce the other panelists who are here, because they're important too. So if you could say your name, grade, school, your district, the number of years you've been on the community council, and some accomplishments that you've been proud of as a part of the council. A lot of things.
My name is Lupe Thornhill, and I'm a junior in high school. And right now I'm at St. Paul College at Gateway, which is kind of like a credit recovery program. Well, like you could take college classes as well, catching up on credits that you missed at another high school. And I'm in District 4, and this is which is St. Paul. And this is my third year in the high school, I believe. And one of my favorite accomplishments. Hasn't even like it's kind of like on its way of being accomplished, but I'm working on a Humans of Central project just because one thing I really did like about Central was the different types of people and how diverse it was, and there was no like group that was really overpowering one another, so I kind of wanted to show like what I really loved about Central just because Central being looked at such a negative light right now, and the people don't really get the recognition. And the most important part of the MYC for me is how it's the resources that we get. Like, we work really closely with MDE, and I've gotten a lot of help and resources and learned a lot from different people. Like, we have, like, this little, not science fair, but it's like in a science fair format at MDE, where, like, the different, like, departments, like, come and like, tell us about, like, what they do, and it's super cool, and, like, information.
My name is Essence Blakemore. This is my fourth year on the council. I'm in the education committee, and I attend Queen Margaret High School. I'm a junior. A thing that I'm proud about with NYC is the 21st Century Grants that we worked on. We worked really close with MDE on that, and we were the only state to like trust youth with making those decisions. So like that's like major impact, major steps, like. Small steps, but it meant a lot to us, and we felt really important doing it, and it was a lot of work. Grant review was no joke. something that's important to me with the NYC is, like she was saying, the resources, but at the same time, the opportunities that become open and available to you. You get so many more opportunities that you probably wouldn't have been open to if you were just a typical junior high school, you know? A lot of people always ask me, like, how do you do this stuff? How did you get involved? Like, where do you go? And honestly, if I wouldn't have been in NYC, I'm not necessarily sure. I'm not sure that I would know how to navigate that and find those opportunities to be in situations like this. So, yeah, that's what really important to me, the resource opportunity and space to have conversation.
Okay, great. I'm Tiaryn Daniels. I am a junior at Park Center High School, which is in Brooklyn Park, Osceola Area Schools District, and Congressional District 3. And also, this is my fourth year on the Minnesota Youth Council. I think what I'm most proud of being on the Youth Council is the confidence that I've gained to know that I deserve a seat at the table and to know that if something's affecting me, that I have the right to put my voice in and to be heard. And just like Essence said, there's so many resources available that I didn't know about, and being able to go back to my school and go back to my community and be like, you know, you can do something about this, there's someone that can help you, and to be able to be a resource myself is something that, you know, I couldn't ask for anything better.
My name is Darren Jackson. I am in District 5, go to the Firebird Career Academy in Minneapolis. Third year on the council, and accomplishments are speaking out more, because I don't know what I would do if MYC hadn't pushed me to be more outspoken. So.
Hi, my name is Coralie Maldonado. I'm a junior at North St. Paul High School. I'm part of the at-large district. This is my first year on NYC. so far, what I'm proud of regarding MYC is the fact that I'm actually a really quiet person and I don't really talk a lot. So what MYC has done for me is kind of give me opportunities to come out of my shell, but little by little not really like throw me in situations where I'm like really, really uncomfortable. So that was important to me, and it's kind of like surprising how much I've changed in the half year that I've been in it so far.
And I'm in Vang, once again. I go to Central High School. I'm a senior there this year. Same school that Lupe attends. And for me, Minnesota Youth Council has really given me the chance to work alongside very amazing people and organizations like the Minnesota Department of Education. Education has been something that's been very important to me that I've been involved in ever since early high school. And I think without MYC, I wouldn't have been able to access as many opportunities as I have been able to this past year, which is what a lot of other members have done to today. Now, jumping into the actual discussion, I think we all agree that we can't really talk about racial equity without talking about discipline. So those are what our first two questions are going to be tackling. And the first one is, what does discipline look like at this school? So,
I came from St. Paul's schools, and I like made a transition into Coral Rapids suburban schools. That's kind of how I think about it, and that's when I really noticed what discipline looked like, because I had been dismissed for like, you know, truancy or something like that. But when I went to Coral Rapids, I noticed the drastic change in discipline between color. And at first, when I was in city schools, it was more or less everybody gets in trouble, like black and brown kids just all together, you get in trouble, like that's just how it is. But when I went to Coral Rapids, it was like known, like people know. It wasn't like a question, like, is it that way, kinda? The staff always deny it, but kids always call it out. And it's like, if that's what they're feeling, if that's what the students are feeling from the staff and the school and the environment, then I mean, you know, it is what it is. And it's not even just like the colored students know. You know, some of our Caucasian students know also, like everybody is like kind of aware, and it's just like a thing that we just deal with. So, I don't know, experiences, a lot of times it's like bickering. A lot of times in my school you get in trouble for a pre-fight. So a pre-fight is like if me and someone are talking really loud or it seems like we're about to like get into an altercation, you'll be suspended for that, like 5 days. And they'll tell you, if you come back again and fight, we'll suspend you for 10 days because you got suspended for a pre-fight, so you already know that this is wrong. So if you come back and do it, we'll suspend you double. So, I don't know, a lot of times you can just, like, tell the difference. So if girls are arguing in the hallway, if they're, like, African-American girls, and if they stand in a particular spot, you know this argument is going to be more intense. Like, this is bound to be a fight opposed to down the hallway and there being, like, I don't know, another group of kids who like to play video games or something, and they're not African American, and they're bickering and fighting. It's not always like, oh, like, oh, you know, it's less than like call security. And a lot of times, like, that's just what keeps happening. People always say, like, we're not even fighting, and then they're like getting calls to the principal office. And sometimes actually like calling in the APs and security seems to like escalate the problem, because now they feel like there's something that they need to battle against or with. So I don't know, for my school, like, that's a big change I've noticed concerning discipline, the city versus suburban. And I don't know, this is like always my perspective because I come from the city, you know, this is a different ball game, you know.
See, I go to Park Center. I live in the suburbs. I've always lived in the suburbs, so I don't have that city comparison that some of my people at this table, my peers have, and I think that's what's so important about this group that we have right now, is that we all have such like different personal experiences and come from such different backgrounds. Because you know, I can't say, you know, what a city school was like, but I can say I think that a problem that I have with discipline at my school is that, you know, look into the handbook, what is the discipline policy? I know that there used to be zero tolerance, but I'm trying to read through my handbook and I'm like, okay, well, it says that we take a zero tolerance stance on things, but I'm looking like, okay, but this doesn't really say anything. And I think when I look at my school, you can tell how parent involvement and those things have a factor on how a student is disciplined. Because it's like, okay, well, my parents are gonna call and I'm gonna get out of this somehow, or I have those connections. Or, you know, students whose parents aren't as involved within the school or aren't as well known, don't have those connections to school activities, you can definitely tell the difference in how they're disciplined and how like things are handled by administration.
Okay, so what does school discipline look at my school? Well, recently my school's kind of resembled in a sense a prison. When I came freshman year, yes, there was a lot of problems. Kids were skipping really easily, and they were smoking weed in the hallways and stuff like that. But I feel like the way they were trying to crack down on all of this is going horribly wrong, and it's racially prejudiced, is what I noticed, because I'll walk every day near where the African American kids are, and we have like two boys. And we have like a behavioral team of four people and they're all there. We have three floors and then that was the atrium and then there's an entire section like by the front doors. So I don't understand why our entire behavioral team was where the black kids were. And then on top of that, it's just like Essence mentioned that kids are getting suspended for 5 days and then getting months of community service for things like pre-fights, for defending themselves when they were trying to avoid a fight, they got hit anyway. And I was one of the best suspended in 5 days and then got months of community service for that. And they tried explaining that and they basically weren't listening to it. So it's based, what behaviors become isn't like, how do we solve this issue so all the kids can learn? It's more like they're looking at the kid and what they look like, and then they're taking the punishment, and then, I don't know how to put it, but they're taking the punishment and kind of like writing out the details of what it's gonna look like based on the physical appearance of the kid. What I've experienced at my school, I explained the entire entire behavioral team being by the black kids, but on top of that, it's like what I experienced last week was they let me. So I was standing by my tablet in the middle of class, kind of like going on it. The teacher didn't say anything, and then I was like really curious about that because like a couple days before, she sent out an African American boy for doing the exact same thing I did. And the only difference was I was a quiet student of color, and he liked to joke around a lot, and he was kind of boisterous and stuff. So it's just like, what was the difference? Like, she just kind of othered us, like, oh no, you're a good colored kid. You don't, it doesn't matter. You can do what you want because I know you're doing your homework or whatever. And then she sent him out of class and wrote him up literally because he wasn't sitting down fast enough for his electronic. So that's an example that I have, that I'm still really angry about,
because
she's one of my favorite teachers, and I was just like, why would you do this? And
yeah, so that happened. And I think we have really good administration at my school. I think they have really good staff overall. And something in defense of them is I feel like a lot of times when they're trying to work with students, and you know, kids are skipping class, they're trying to work with them, you know, give them a reason to want to go to school, and I feel like some students or some parents don't understand that, and they're looking at that like, well, why, if they're skipping class, like, why are you trying to mix them? Why is, why aren't they getting that equal treatment? But I think there's a lack of knowledge, like, within students and within parents, and how to work with students who are having trouble with school, that, you know, that you shouldn't just suspend them or try to get them out, that you should work with them, and I think that's sometimes hard. When not everybody understands that.
I don't know, I just have one more thing to add to that about what both of you said.
said with the student handbook and also like how certain students are treated, I've noticed that if a student doesn't necessarily know the rules or policies, like the administration will like run straight over them. Like me, I'm not necessarily like the quiet person, I guess. Like I'm, you probably know that, but I'm really vocal, and when I have concerns or I want to know things, I come to the table and I ask and I try to figure it out and try to come up with a solution. And the administration of my school, they handle me really well. Like they know, like all the tests, like let's talk business, you know. But I have noticed when other students like try to come with the same approach, if they don't articulate it the way I do, or if they don't have the same mannerism, or if they come from somewhere else and it's just like not the same way that they carry themselves, like they get treated a certain way. And I called them on one day, and I'm just like, why don't you treat them how you treat me? And then they're like, well. And I'm just like, that's a problem because you can't even answer that question. So it's like, depending on how much you know, they'll treat you differently too. So not even just being quiet, but how much do you know? Like how much you gonna get away with?
You know your rights.
Yeah, kind of like that.
Oh no, I just noticed that it said, what do you wish discipline looked like? So I felt like there should be commentary on that. Something that I noticed, because I had with the help of Brandon Smith from the Minnesota, from he helped me lead a solution not to stop kids walk out. And after that, I started brainstorming ideas that I wanted to see different in my school. One is the police. One is North St. Paul. The police are literally down the street. Brute force, I feel, will never be an answer, because I have literally seen the police take kids and slam them on the floor at school, and it's just like, it gets scary and it's unnecessary. And I also think that instead of suspension, like what social justice is kind of driving for or going towards is putting alternative programs, and not the lousy kind, like we have CLAWS, where it's basically a bunch of like really sad board games in the middle of the table. Actual programs that will get resources that these kids need, mentoring for them, like mentioned earlier, and or just letting them kind of relax and have fun. Like they're not even allowed to shoot basketballs into empty trash cans. A kid got in trouble. But that's kind of what I want to change in my school. Like actually helping them aside from telling them, oh, don't do this, and forcing them to sit still. And maybe that's not who they are. Not all kids are like that.
Togetherness or like girl power, but like just the relationships that girls have with each other, because like sometimes it's like insecurity issues like within their own selves, so they fight with each other and they don't like see that, so like it comes out in a negative way, but really it's just the girl crying out because she doesn't always feel pretty, you know. And I just don't feel like school looks at stuff like that, like the mental health aspect. It's like a lot of different ways to look at this like girl drama. Like the problem is there's like an underlying issue, like there's the flower and that's the problem, but like, well, maybe not the flower, but you know. And then there's like the seed, like the issue. So like, I don't know, like I just don't think schools look at enough of that kind of stuff, and like fights outside of school, like, well, what did happen on Facebook book, like besides the suspension of cyberbullying, like let's look at these comments and see like what are they really talking about, like what are you upset for, and then like address that issue and then see like, well, how do you feel now that it's addressed, your needs are met, what do you feel? Do you need to attack? Do you need to sit down for a while, or do you want to let loss? You know, like just have those conversations. I would like to see that, because I feel like that would save a bunch of time.
I guess I'll wrap up this question, but I think my biggest wish for discipline policies is that there's equal access, because I believe personally that a lot of discipline is tied into mental health, and that we know that all students don't have access. Are you getting help from a counselor, or are you acting out and then getting in trouble within the school? Which, you know, we know leads to the justice system, and then that never goes well. So I think in my experience, and what I can speak on, is that students need that access to get help before problems